Now, when students are applying for admission to universities, do they apply for funding separately, or it's actually part of the whole application process?
So this may be a bit discipline specific, but generally in the US, students are funded on teaching assistantships and research assistantships. Maybe I should say it's research assistantships first and teaching assistantships.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are a whole lot of other external sources of funding, fellowships, etc., that are on top of that. And because the graduate programs that are especially research oriented are run essentially on those research projects that faculty attract external funding to run, the students are employed on those projects and they are funded, their stipend is coming from those projects. And so most universities will not admit a student if they cannot fund it.
Okay.
There are a few universities where they admit students without funding, and then a funding application is a separate process. But very large proportion of the schools, the funding is tied with the admission process.
Okay, so you don't apply for the funding separately from the whole application process for admission?
No, a few programs like business programs and such, where most of the students are either funded by corporations or themselves, would admit and not have any consideration for funding. And you know that before you apply, that you have to know how you're going to be funded. And you have to be explicit about that. If the program doesn't advertise a lot of funding available, there probably isn't. And if you apply, it means you know how you're going to be funded.
Mm.
But for programs that are especially research oriented, not necessarily professional degrees, the students, the graduate students, do most of the research.
Okay.
And the research pays them. The research project pays them. So it's a very nice synergy there. Between the research has to be done, the students need funding, get the best students to run the research project supervised by the advisors, who are also very, very involved, by the way. And maybe you supplement that with some teaching assistantships. And that's how a lot of students are funded in the US, local and international students. There are quite a number of fellowships also that may be applied for independent of the university. And then when you get the fellowship, then you choose which university you want to take the fellowship to.
Okay.
So there are, in fact, some of these are US government supported fellowships, such as the Fulbright. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So mine is not to study, but to it's a cultural exchange, more or less, program. So I'm here in Ghana to teach and do research, to bring the goodwill of the people of the US to Ghana, to also learn something about Ghana. That is different from somebody who wants to study in the US, funded by the US government. The Fulbright program for foreign students, it's called Fulbright Foreign Student Program, I think. These are for people who are employed in the public sector. It may be academic, it may be non-academic, who are given the leave to go study in the US, get a degree, come back and work in the institution. So academics take advantage of this a lot, right?
Yeah.
And there are different shades of Fulbright programs and available in Ghana, in almost every country that I know. There are some Fulbright opportunities there. And it's very competitive, but it's also a pretty decent opportunity, because maybe in a particular year, maybe you have 5 or 6, maybe 10 Fulbright fellowships awarded to Ghanaians.
Whoa.
Right? And you get 2 years of funding to go to study in the US.
Mm-hmm.
You choose which universities you would like to go, but you don't have to settle on a university before your Fulbright is,
okay,
is awarded. And once you are shortlisted and you are confirmed to be likely funded, then they go to the universities and say, this individual has applied for Fulbright, we are funding them. What can you offer them? Mm-hmm. So the university has to put some cost share in, like maybe offer some tuition waivers and some other things to make it possible for you to get extended time at the university beyond the 2 years of Fulbright funding.
Oh, okay. I think that is well understood. So if there's any student watching this interview today and they have plans of applying for funding to invest in the US, aside the fact that they search for the school and then they do the application, is there any other thing that this student needs to do in order to increase their chances of getting this funding opportunity?
Yeah, so this is sort of related to earlier questions you asked about what's the first thing you should do,
yeah,
to prepare yourself for applying for, you know, opportunities in the US. It's important to understand that you are not the only one or part of a small number of people who are applying to these programs in the US. There are a lot of applications. And if you are involved in graduate programs as I am and selecting students, it is actually heartbreaking. The number of qualified students who apply that you just can't take on.
Yeah.
Because faculty have positions and they are filled, and the university may have one or two fellowships or scholarships, a few teaching assistantships, and it just can't go around. So you need to understand that you are entering a competition, mm-hmm, and put your best foot forward, you know.
Okay.
Make your application clear and unambiguous. Of course, you start out getting the best grades you can, so that's something you can't change.
Mm-hmm.
A good, attractive resume you can write, but your GPA will be the same GPA no matter how you develop your resume. So first you set your mind on excelling as much as you can at the level that you are at before you go on to apply to schools in the US. But once you get there to the process of application, you really need to have applications that are done with precision and no ambiguities. There are no typos, too many typos in an application, and it will be tossed aside because nobody likes to read, to try to imagine what you are trying to say.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm talking about the GPAs. There's this lady from Nigeria called Faye, and a friend of mine, she graduated with a GPA of 2.2. And she got this funded opportunity to study in the US. She read agriculture for her BSc. And you know, usually we used to think that maybe such a GPA can't get someone a funding in the US. So how does it happen? Does it kind of give people who have kind of low GPAs a hope that they may still get opportunities for funding?
Certainly. And we've seen some of these, call it odd, situations like this, and it kind of defies the standard rule, right? But if you look at the number of people from Nigeria who have gotten admission to the US universities, somebody with a GPA of 2.2 may be a very small percentage of those people.
Mm.
So this is not an average person. Now, there are a lot of peculiar situations that are considered also in admissions, and nobody knows what's in their personal statement.
Yeah.
They may also have just an outstanding experience. In addition to your GPA, you have to have a lot of practical experience. You have to show that you are actually in the field. Like you love what you're doing, and you translate what you're doing to make impact on people's lives. Some do it through outreach. Some are excellent writers. So there are a lot of other things that many universities would want to see a sample of your writing, for example. Because for graduate studies, you're going to write a thesis, and if you have great grades, but you can't write a paragraph, nobody's going to want you, because you're going to write a whole thesis, and it's a mess if you have to deal with somebody who cannot write, or just get lazy when it comes to writing. You can do a lot of, some people can do a lot of field work, but you just can't gather the same energy to write. And writing prolifically can be a big asset for researchers. So there may be a lot of other things that support that GPA. And in her personal statement, she may well have also explained why she ended up with the GPA that she did, you know.
Okay. Yeah. So you can also explain that too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. And we have interviewed students and sometimes gotten them to explain things in their transcript that stand out as odd.
Okay.
You know, and some people started rough and then their trajectory showed that they were getting better and better over time. Sometimes that is even more desirable than somebody who started very high and end up with mediocre grades at the end, but they still have a good average.
Okay.
If I'm taking two people to consider them for admission and they have the same GPA, or one started high and then ended low, and one started low and ended high, I'm taking the latter. Wow. Because this means that their trajectory is, they are getting better over time.
Okay, so when we consider someone, for example, who has got, okay, let's talk about this extra calculus, for example. So someone who got such a GPA, let's say, can we say that maybe extra calculus might have played a role in the application process? Maybe they engage in several extra calculus activities.
Yeah, so when I said they may have other things that are pluses on their resume, you know, we in Ghana, when we say extracurricular, we kind of think about sports and things like that, but this is beyond sports. We are talking about something like outreach and engagement, actually using the knowledge in their field to make impact in people's lives in very explicit ways. Some people are very active on social media, discussing research, sending the latest research, making some real difference in some ways. These can be like what you're doing. Like, you are talking to scientists, you are talking to people who might have something to say, and you are using that to reach a lot more people who might not have the opportunity to talk to the same people. Right?
Yeah.
So I would say if you had the opportunity to do graduate study, in my evaluating you, your application for your potential, I see more potential in you using your graduate education to reach more people than somebody who does the book and doesn't talk to anyone, but just gets the high grades in exams.
Okay. I fully understand that. Now, it has turned out to be that mostly people get this admission, but it's difficult for them to get a visa to actually leave their country to go study. Sometimes they try to mess up in the whole interview process. I know you don't work at the embassy anyway, but no matter, you have some kind of ideas or tips to give we, the students who are watching today, some tips about interviews at the embassy. So is there any tip that you like to give students who, when they are attending these interviews, how they should answer the questions and all that?
So something that, and I'm not a consular rep by any means, and so I don't know all the reasons for which visas might be denied, but it is part of the job of the consular officer to decipher some of the stories that people come to tell at the embassy, to make sure that the person who is applying to go to school is going to school. It's not looking to enter the United States, then work, minimize school or even abandon school, and, you know, go look for money. There is a lot of temptation to do that, of course, especially when you are in an economy that has a lot of challenges. A lot of people with very good university travel and they never go to school again. So most of the interviews, and I had to go through some of my own when I was an undergrad and then to earlier graduate studies. Most of the interview questions and related documentation that they want is towards geared towards making sure that you'll be well funded without the pressure to turn to working and abandoning the education objective. Okay. And it's sometimes it is difficult for people to do that because they have admission with not very good funding package. If you tell a US university that you will fund yourself, and there are a lot of people who go to study in the US and they fund themselves.
Okay.
So if you tell a university that you are capable of funding yourself, you will be admitted if you qualify for admission, but then you will be required to show evidence that you can fund yourself. That evidence is not trivial. Okay, so you will have to maybe show bank statements and things like that, that, you know, it's not like somebody suddenly found a ton of money and put it in a bank account and say, go show it to the embassy. They know how to read bank statements. They know how to investigate a little bit whether this money is money available to you. Mm-hmm. And the universities usually want at least your first year of funding guaranteed to be there when you get there. The universities, the consulates.
Mm-hmm.
So the university, when they give you funding, they do this paper called I-20.
Yeah.
And on the I-20, they spell out the cost of your education every year in the US. And they show your sources of funding on the I-20. So the university has done its homework in issuing the I-20 to you to show the agreement that they have come with you about how you're going to be funded. If any of the I-20 information shows that some of the funding or a good part of the funding is coming from you, you better also have the proper documentation that you do have that money.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you will go to the interview and it doesn't work out, because it's not even a lot of questions anybody is going to ask you. It's what they are looking at in front of them. Of your I-20, of what bank statements and other things. If you have full funding from a university, you are not required to provide a bank statement.
Okay. That was the next question I wanted to ask. Whether if you have a full funding, you still need to provide that bank statement.
No, and I was admitted to programs in the US. When we talk about full funding, that does not include your cost of travel. And cost of travel is a big chunk of your initial cost of going to school in the US. You know, I remember in the late 90s, early 2000s, actually spending months raising the money to buy my ticket to take on. Yeah, because I had received a research assistantship from a university, but that doesn't cover travel.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching or research assistantship doesn't cover travel. Wow. You will have to pay for your ticket by yourself. If you have a Fulbright or something, a fellowship, more likely there is travel also involved. But somebody with an undergraduate degree who is just finishing national service or something, when you ask them to buy today, a flight will cost about $2,000 to go to the US. It's dollars too. And you know the savings rate of Ghanaians and young people in Ghana. So you just don't have that money in the bank.
That's true.
And even that, just that, if you don't have that, it may make your life miserable. But that's not what the consulates don't ask you how you're going to buy your ticket if you have full funding from the university.
Mm.
They know you'll find your way there, and when you get there, you'll be funded. So when they're asking for bank statement, they're asking for bank statements to cover the shortfall in the funding package that you have received from the university.
Okay. So, is it possible that students can transfer from their local universities in maybe Africa to the US and continue that whatever program they're reading in Africa?
No. There are universities that have some kind of sandwich programs where they have a MOUs with universities and based on very, very specific research partnerships that they have formed with those universities, offer part of the degree in the US, part of the degree in another country. And the degree is awarded either by the US university or by the foreign university, depending on how the agreement is done. That kind of program, you are required to do part of the degree in multiple countries. And it can be a very rich structure for a degree, because you get exposed to a lot of different things in different countries. But the way curricula are built, there is no mechanism that I know of for somewhere in the middle of, say, a master's program, going to the US and simply carrying all the coursework to another university. Mm-hmm. Even universities between the US universities, that kind of transfer is not easy.
Okay.
Yeah. If you have done a lot of coursework in one university and you decide to go to another university, some courses may transfer, not all courses necessarily will transfer.
Okay, so it's more like, for the most part, you have to start already.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, you may be able to transfer some courses, but determining the equivalence of courses to be transferred is also a pretty involved task. And somebody is going to flag some courses and say, these are not equivalent, or these don't meet our standard of rigor, or whatever. And so you may be able to transfer some credits, but it is not a formal transfer of the degree to another university.
Okay, so my penultimate question in this discussion will be, there may be a student watching who may have had a funding opportunity, but then they don't have a means to provide for their bank statement at the embassy. What would be your best advice to this student?
So if they have a funding opportunity, then they don't have to have a bank statement.
Okay.
If they have full funding, any other kind of arrangement that requires a bank statement implies that you are not receiving full funding from the university.
Okay.
And it's usually part of the admission process that you state your funding needs, and the university determines whether they are able to meet your funding needs. And there are standards of how much it costs to live in any place in the US for a year, and so cost of living plus your tuition, part of it is usually waived and all that. So these are all calculated to determine the funding level that the universities give you. So a university in California, for example, may fund you twice as much as a university somewhere in, say, Arkansas or Louisiana.
Yeah.
But the funding is tailored to match the cost of living in those areas.
Okay.
And the cost of education as determined by the tuition levels and so forth. So if you match the university with your level of funding, then if there is a shortfall, it is the university that issues that paper, the I-20,
okay,
to you. The university says it costs a student, say, $25,000 a year. That's a very low number, by the way. The numbers are usually in $40,000 and $50,000 a year to study in this university. From all the resources the university has made available, all the funding university has made available, we've met maybe 15,000 of that. So if you still want to take up the opportunity, you have to show evidence that you have $10,000 a year from somewhere else,
okay,
to make it possible for you to study. And you say yes, then when you are going for the interview, your I-20 is saying you have a negative $10,000 of funding, and you have to show how that will be covered. That's how you will need bank statements. But there are a lot of fields for which that kind of funding arrangement is not necessary. That if you apply to the right programs and with the patience and proper targeting, you will have funding for which you don't have to do a bank statement as part of your interview.
Okay.
And yeah. Sometimes you have dependents, and dependents funding is not necessarily part of the funding that the university gives you.
Okay.
So that part, you know, you are admitted, you are given full funding, but then you want to travel with the husband or with the wife or with the child or children, then they calculate the additional expenses needed to be able to do that. And sometimes that escalates very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to cover that difference.
Okay.
And that is how people might end up with just not sufficient funding, and the consulates are not going to have that, you know, they're going to look at that and say you're not ready.
Wow. Okay. I think the last person that we'll be talking about today will be, so right now we've actually spoken about lots of stuff in this interview. What's going to be your final words to viewers who have plans of studying in the US?
So I would like to inform students who are interested in studying in the US that there are a lot of resources you can tap to start the process right and hopefully not waste a lot of energy doing things that are not, you know, productive in this sense. The US Embassy has an education section. They have an educational advisor, and they are open to the public. You can go talk to them. You tell them your field of interest, your, you know, some other interests that they may ask you to explain a little more about yourself and what you want to achieve in going to study in the US. And they can begin to point you to even specific institutions that you may want to consider.
Okay. Meaning
they also inform you about tests, how to prepare for those tests, all those things. And people don't utilize those resources necessarily.
This is actually the first time I'm hearing you say this, because I didn't know that you could actually go to the embassy concerning these educational systems.
They even organize educational programs for people who are interested in studying in the US. Occasionally they do. And there are also affiliates partners with the embassy in making that more information more accessible. In fact, in Kumasi, there is a Education USA office right there at Atonsu, where the people working there, just like you can walk in to the embassy educational section and ask for advice. People go to Education USA, and it's like an organization that is not directly the US government, but that's all the work that the US embassy does in terms of pointing you to the right resources too. So I think that's definitely a resource that should be used more, that I think is underutilized.
Okay.
And I would also like to say that the people who get admitted to institutions are the people who apply.
Okay? Very true.
So if you don't apply, nobody knows you are there, nobody knows your credentials. So you have to be proactive in applying for things. When you see that you meet the qualifications for it, put in your application and let the process take its course. Sometimes surprises happen, right? I've said that you don't just try to meet the minimum requirements, excel, exceed. But then there are people who meet the minimum requirements. Sometimes they get admitted, and you wonder how they made it. Right?
Yeah, very true. This is very true, especially like the example I gave you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, you know, okay, I said that was the last question, but I have another one. So,
sure.
Now, at the beginning of the interview, you spoke about the coding million of professors. How is it very easy for students to contact the professors of the department?
Oh yes, so almost every professor in a US university has their email online.
Okay.
It is actually required of us to have our contact information as part of our web profile.
Okay.
And it's for reasons like this and more. people should be able to reach out to you and ask you questions, not only about wanting to be educated in the US. Some people have questions about the research you do. Some people have just some practical questions, and you're the one who does the fish research and they have seen a fish and you don't understand, you want you to explain it to them. There are people who look for partnerships to work with professors, etc., etc. So the email is available to the public. And of course, the same email, others put other objectives, find, and they contact you. So I don't know, maybe 2 or 3 times a week I receive email from prospective students. There's a very high rate of contact from all over the world.
Wow.
And sometimes when I'm traveling like this, it's very hard to respond to these emails expeditiously. But when I'm available at home, I do a lot of responding to try to at least give students an up or down answer when you get these kinds of emails. And for some, you just look at it and you know they don't have a chance and you don't want them to waste their time, you tell them right away. For others, great record, but you just don't have the funding for them at this time. You tell them, you know, I'm keeping your application on file. If an opportunity arises, I will let you know. And believe me, I've kept students like that and eventually found funding.
Wow, that's
reach out to them and call them. And some of them, they are so good. By the time you reach out to them, they've actually found an opportunity elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And that's still a happy ending.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
So cold emailing, you can call it cold emailing, but it's the standard mode of operation is you email people.
Okay. Yeah, I was actually in discussion with this friend who told me that it's much better that students email their graduate advisors instead of the professors. And the reason she gave was that the professors may not reply you, but then the graduate advisors will always reply you.
Depending on the university and the program, there may be a different culture around responding to people who just randomly contact you and ask about educational opportunities. But in our system, in Virginia Tech, so I'm the director of our graduate program. So when our administrative assistants get inquiries about graduate program, they forward it to me. I get direct emails from people too. But my email is out there not only as a professor that you may contact to talk to about studying directly with me. A lot of people also take my email and they ask me about our graduate program in general and which professors they should be talking to. And so even when you send it to the admins, it may still end up with me. But I have to say that we, as professors, we don't all respond to these things at the same rate, right? Mm-hmm. Some people have more time for this. Maybe value this experience in touch exchange with students more than others do. Or they just don't have the time. Some researchers are really busy. And then in some graduate programs, not many, but in some, the admission is made of a certain fixed number of students every year. They all get funding, research assistantships and teaching assistantships through the department to start before they decide which professor they want to work with. So in that case, the professors are not really out there recruiting their own students necessarily indirectly. Because there will be a pool of students who will be admitted,
yeah,
out of which some of them will end up in their lab. So the incentive to coordinate the process of having good applicants apply to the program is not there compared to, say, us, where we don't admit a student if we haven't identified a professor who says, yes, I have the funding to support them, mm-hmm, and I would like to work with them. These conditions have to be met before the student even applies.
Okay.
You know, so we don't let students waste their time throwing applications in the system. Some still do, but almost all of them, no matter how good their credentials, end up not getting admitted because anticipating their application.
Okay. That was a very educative session you had with us. So, Professor Frimpong, thank you very much for your time. You've done more to educate us on studies abroad from other countries around the world. And I actually hope that we interact more from here with respect to other subjects.
Absolutely. And it's a pleasure to be with you.
Yeah, thank you very much.